My name is Yvette Hahn, and I am this year's chairman of the VIP Distinguished EBCs. This program is one of many put on by the Undergraduate Business Council. Today, we are joined by Jay Hartzell, Dean of the McCombs School of Business, and Stacy Smith, Group President of Manufacturing, Sales, and Operations, and former CFO of Intel. We will begin tonight with a conversation between Dean Hartzell and Mr. Smith. Then, we will open up the floor to a Q&A from the audience. Stacy Smith joined Intel in 1988, and his career has spanned every geography and many organizations, from head of EMEA sales and marketing, chief information officer, and almost a decade as CFO, and most recently, president of manufacturing, operations, and sales. Mr. Smith led Intel through the Great Recession as CFO and has been critical in transforming Intel from PC to data centric. I'm also proud to say that Stacy Smith is a graduate of the University of Texas at Austin, where he received both his BBA and MBA degrees in finance by 1988. Smith is also deeply involved with organizations in his local community. Mr. Smith serves on the board of directors of Autodesk Inc., a 3D design, engineering, and entertainment software company, and also serves on the board of directors of Virgin America and the board of directors of the American Heart Association, a nonprofit organization. Now that you've all heard a little bit about our guest speaker, let's get started. As a reminder, today's event will end promptly at 6:30 p.m. We would greatly appreciate if you could refrain from leaving early and from using electronic devices. Well, without further ado, please help me welcome Dean Hartzell and Mr. Smith.
Welcome, everybody. Stacy, thanks for doing this.
My pleasure.
Welcome. I'm trying to establish your cred as being from a tech company and helping you help with my microphone.
The least I can do. I can push the button.
So let's start and talk a little bit about Intel. And you know, in your time as CFO and then president of manufacturing operations, sales, what's Intel done differently to distinguish itself from its competitors?
Yeah, you know, I have the benefit of having worked at Intel for 30 years, so I just watched this company grow and transform. Kern and I were talking, Kern's my chief of staff down there. You know, when I joined Intel, we were probably 10,000 people and $1 billion in revenue, and today we're 100,000 people and north of $60 billion in revenue. I think Intel has been an interesting case study, and I think the next case study is just now being written of how the company has transformed through different eras of computing. And you know, at one point we were a memory company. We got our butts handed to us in the international market because we weren't efficient in manufacturing. We pretty much lost that market to the Japanese manufacturers, made a transition to being a CPU company that was very focused on the PC market. And we're just now coming through the tail end of that, of the next transformation, where we transformed to being a company that's at the heart of analytics in the cloud. And then we're building solutions in all these really interesting areas where we're starting to see compute and connectivity in places where we didn't used to see it. So things like autonomous driving, or smart cities, smart factories, you know, 3D gaming, virtual reality, those kinds of things. So we see this explosion of different devices that compute and connect, and connect to the server infrastructure that we put in place. And the thing that kind of puts all that together is data right now. And I've had a variety of conversations today with a bunch of really smart, motivated students, and I think one of the biggest trends that's really pushing the market over the next 5 years is going to be how much data is being generated and collected. And so, you know, my one piece of advice is anything you can do that builds your statistics skills or your data analytics skills, they're just critical because it's going to be a phenomenal amount of data over the next several years.
And you talked a little about, you know, the journey of Intel over the last 30 years and, you know, what's important now, how that's happened. Talk about your own personal journey over that same time as you've gone through your career at Intel. And what would you like to share about that, or what have you picked up along the way, or how have you personally changed, you've developed?
Yeah. Well, so, like I said, I've been in Intel for 30 years. We were talking upstairs that I think one of the reasons I ended up in an operational finance role at a tech company is because in 1987 or so, Steve Jobs came and did one of these speeches on campus, and I had the honor of getting to see him. So, you know, really, Steve Jobs, he was in his late 20s. This was Apple 1.0. And Steve had the ability to just kind of paint this reality distortion field around them that, you know, whatever you believed walking in, when you walked out, you believed what he believed. And he had this sense that technology was going to change the world in a positive way. And so, you know, that was really the reason that I joined Intel. It's been this incredible journey over the 30 years. But I have the benefit now of I get to go and teach at Intel. I teach, you know, kind of 10 key things that I've learned, leadership principles. I won't bore you with all 10 of them, but I'll kind of hit the top three. Number one is, if you go into your jobs thinking like an owner, you know, thinking of problems like you own the company as opposed to you're an employee of the company, it gives you actually the perfect perspective from which to think about, you know, what levers do I want to push, what risks am I willing to take, you know, how do I mitigate those risks. So go into every opportunity thinking like you own the company, will cause you to make better decisions. On decision making, you know, number five on the list is be looking for opportunities to prove yourself wrong and use data to make decisions. And I tell people who work for me, you know, if you don't have data, then you just have an opinion. If you walk into my office with an opinion, we're going to have an exchange of opinions, which means you walk in with yours and you walk out with mine, because I'm the senior guy in the organization. If you walk into my office with data, you actually have the ability to prove that I'm heading down a bad path or I'm making a bad decision, and that data is critical. I think now as we move into the world of business analytics and big data, just to back to that point, that becomes more and more important. I think that separates good companies from bad companies and great companies from good companies. And then the last one on the list is move fast. And it sometimes can be a conflict of number two, look for data. But I'm a big believer of you often don't have perfect data to make a decision. Moving is better than standing still. And once an organization is moving, it becomes easier to say, okay, we chose this direction, but we really need to be going here. So you can make, you know, slight course corrections. But when you're standing still, you're just stuck. And in a world where disruption happens as fast as it does, you know, being still means you're going to be overkill. So move fast.
So when you think about those things, you talk about teaching a class there, and, you know, our students come out, maybe they're 23 years old and joining an organization like Intel, and where they are in the organization chart, they're not close to the owner. So how do you instill that mentality and get even the people kind of throughout the organization to be thinking in that way, whether it's, you know, move quickly or think like an owner, those principles?
We actually teach a class called Think Like an Owner, and to just get them to think about things from exactly that perspective. We use case studies to do it, but a lot of it is just, you know, putting yourself in your boss's seat and say, how would I make the decision if I was in that seat? If this was my company and I owned it, you know, what would I do? Or would I take a risk? But a lot of it is just framing the question in the right way, and it can really change your point of view. So we do give a lot of tools and techniques. We find, you know, we hire great people from schools like McCombs and schools like University of Texas. So they come in with the right skills, but teaching them to frame the question in the right way is really the critical part.
And then back to the data, maybe that's framing the answer in the right way as well. So
exactly.
Yeah. So what about, you know, you've got after this career, what's left that you feel like you're still learning? So you talked earlier today among some of us that you like to learn, and that's part of why you like to provide your job and you have. But what's left that you still think about today?
Oh, I probably have more to learn today than I did 30 years ago when I started. At least 30 years ago, I was more sure of the answers. You know, it's the world is changing so fast that I think if you come into work in the morning and you believe you've got the answers, you're destined to make a big mistake. You know, when we look at things like autonomous driving, you know, 2 years ago, this was just a concept, and today it's happening. I mean, you may have seen Waymo's announcement yesterday that they're setting loose on the city of Phoenix a bunch of cars that don't even have the safety driver in the driver's seat. And 2 years ago, I would not have predicted that this was the case. And so, when you start looking at the underlying technologies around that, around how the sensor hub works and how it fuses with the driving system, how the data analytics works, how the high-def mapping system works, you know, these are fundamentally complex technology questions, and so as one of the leaders of Intel, I can throw myself in to really understand the technology all about, figure out what the implications are on our business, and so I'm constantly trying to learn new things, grow my skill set, I think the organization does a good job of that in terms of how we rotate people around and build skills and capabilities. You know, it's just to be a learning organization, I think, is one of the core competencies that you have to have. And then personally, I'm always trying to learn new things. We were talking about tennis earlier. I love to get up to a 4-0 and, you know, learn how to cook Mediterranean food and improve my poker game and all those things.
I spent thousands of dollars on a 2-minute backhand, so I understand. We talked before about a little bit of selection bias. We bring up people with these incredible careers, and there's this, you know, path that you've been on, and it may have the temptation to look easy in hindsight. But can you talk a little about things, maybe hiccups you faced, roadblocks, failures, things you overcame to get a sense of you know, lessons learned as you hit those things in one's career?
Yeah, I'll hit, you know, maybe three different examples of failures or things we missed and what the learnings were. So I'd say the first one was when I had come back from running Europe, Middle East, and Africa. I was chief information officer, and we were doing a big system implementation. And I had a sense as we were going through, so I was relatively new in the CIO role and didn't come through the IT organization, so I was learning. But I had a sense that the answers I was getting were too high level. I wasn't seeing enough business unit involvement in a system that we were going to put in place for their behalf. And ultimately, we got right up to implementation of this thing. I was about 6 months in the job, and it just failed. It was a failed system implementation on something that was pretty important on our supply chain. And so you just, you know, so A, one nice thing about Intel is we don't fire you for that. You know, we let you have one of those mistakes and learn from it. But you know, you really start to learn kind of how to see the signs of a project that's, you know, on track versus not on track, being able to dive into the data. So that was a fundamental learning for me. As a new CFO, I kind of became CFO just as the Great Recession hit. And so there was no failure there, but being able to come to grips with, you know, helping to run a $50 billion company at the time during a time of great uncertainty where you didn't know whether, you know, we'd stepped off into the abyss of another depression, whether the financial markets were going to start shutting down around us. You know, was one of those trial by fire things, and I read some of Bernanke's writings, and I can definitely sympathize to just how much uncertainty there was out there. And we didn't get everything right, but we got, you know, more right than wrong, and we actually found opportunities through that to invest countercyclically in everybody else. And those were the investments that we probably had the highest return in the last 20 years on. Just we were investing, and other people were pulling back, and that was just fundamentally the right decision. And then I'd say the other big one is, you know, as one of the leaders of the company, we missed the impact of low-power tablets on the overall PC market, and that was a massive disruption to our business. So, you know, now with the benefit of hindsight, we've seen about 100 million units of the PC market go away, which is about a quarter of the market. While we were building our businesses in the data center and in other places, we're growing again, we're actually seeing great growth rates, but we went through a very significant transformation with disruption to our business. One that I think would cripple a lot of other companies. Luckily, and with good execution, we made it through it, but we weren't nearly as externally focused enough to see that coming and then be able to take some of the mitigating actions that we ultimately had to take when we took on late.
So talk a little about, you know, you mentioned Intel and its ability to adapt and be innovative and ride out some turbulence. But can you talk a little bit for the students about sort of the dynamics of being on such a large firm, a Fortune 50, huge, massive organization, and how do you compete with small, nimble firms? How should they think about maybe their career paths and those kinds of trade-offs across those kinds of firms?
Yeah.
And, you know, come back to maybe your experiences with having adjusted those kinds of moments in time when they had to adapt.
You know, I'd say the first thing is I don't really think of this as a large company, and I think that's actually a healthy way to think about business. You know, each of our businesses we try to make relatively autonomous. We tend to set goals for that business that, you know, allow them to move fast. When I have leaders that work for me, I try to give them enough room so that they're not always having to come back to headquarters to make decisions, so they can compete on a global playing field and move fast. And when we hire, you know, finance professionals to come work in those businesses, we really try to set them up to be the CFO of the business, you know, to move fast, to make decisions. And so, you know, we have relatively, for us, you know, could be 500 people or 1,000 people or 2,000 people. We have relatively small organizations that are focused on autonomous driving, for example, or machine learning or artificial intelligence. And when you manage things at that level, you can move pretty fast. If you try to think of it as, well, I got to manage the 100,000 person level, then everything tends to get slowed down. On a personal basis, I find one of the skills is you should have as little friction as possible between the senior leaders and the people doing the work. And it's one thing that I've always valued about Intel is, you know, we're in an intense industry, but we're pretty informal. And so anybody can walk in my queue and say, hey, I want to talk about this problem. You know, I can go to a content expert that's 3 or 4 levels down in the organization and say, hey, let's actually have a debate about, you know, what we're doing in this particular business and make a decision.
They don't freak out.
Sometimes, but not usually. We tend to be pretty informal.
And maybe talk a little about what challenges does Intel face as far as getting talent to come. So, and you know, if you were thinking about in their shoes, if they're thinking about pros and cons of joining organizations like yours versus some other options, what's attractive if you were to go back to when you're finishing school here?
Yeah.
In hindsight, what's attractive about an opportunity like Intel today?
So, I'll answer that in two parts. That, you know, there's some areas where we just naturally get the kind of strongest talent in the world that wants to come work for us. So, if you're a PhD in device physics and you want to work on, you know, how you solve Moore's Law problems that are 5 years out, they all want to come work for us. And so, we hire the best talent everywhere in the world for that. Then you get into some of the emerging areas, and I think a challenge for us is that, you know, a lot of the places where we're trying to grow, machine learning, you know, artificial intelligence, autonomous driving, these are really hot areas. And so often, you know, when competing for talent, you know, you're facing the startup that is specific to an area versus a big company like Intel that has an investment in an area. And so there's a share of mind issue that we have that we have to overcome. We have to make sure people understand we're a very broad, diverse company that's not just doing processors for the PC market. In terms of the value proposition that we have, you know, as I think about somebody coming out of college and might, you know, be contemplating between those two roles, I think the value proposition is we're so big and diverse that we can build a very broad base of skills. And I think that's particularly true for somebody that's coming into the business side of Intel. You get to work in a lot of different businesses. You get to learn autonomous driving or smart cities or virtual reality. And you can do that all inside of one company. I think that's a core value proposition. I'd say the second thing, and the last thing I'll say on this is, one of the reasons I chose Intel so many years ago was something that I heard Steve Jobs subsequently say, which is pick a career that allows you to make a positive dent on the universe. And that is one of the things I really value about Intel. We're doing things that fundamentally change people's lives in a positive way. And so, you know, relative to some of the other career choices that I had over my career, you know, I really like the fact that I work for a company that tries to do the right things in the right way and change the world in a positive way.
And you talk about those changes and with the positive dent. What are the challenges today that you're hoping that the leaders of engineers and business leaders of tomorrow can solve?
Yeah, I mean, there's small things like global warming, saving people's lives, improving the quality of lives and the quality of cities. I mean, when you really think about the possibility of technology and some of these fundamentally important areas, I think there's no better place to be. I had the opportunity to sit down with the heads of the different school of medicine at Stanford not too long ago. And so there's, I guess, 9 schools of medicine, so we had 7 of the heads. And we did a round table at dinner, and I was asking what are the most interesting things going on in their specific area. And every one of them, with the exception of pathology, said it's technology. And it's, you know, it's the ability to say, you know, your problem isn't a generic problem, it's a specific issue. How do I characterize that? How do I then come up with a drug treatment regimen or a chemotherapy regimen that's very specifically targeted to the specific issue that you have? And they're seeing outcomes that are just off the chart in terms of, you know, being able to improve the quality of people's lives and the length of people's lives. Yeah, it's a small example, but you can't do that without a massive amount of computation, a massive amount of analytics, and that kind of thing. Those are the kinds of problems we're trying to solve.
And one of the, you know, you've done a couple of things about autonomous vehicles, the growth of technology and data, and global warming. And so I was at a conference a week or two ago, and they were talking about as autonomous vehicles come along, we're going to all ride share. Yeah, we don't need as many cars. That's going to be great for the environment and the energy usage. And at the same time, you've got computing needs growing. So have you all thought about or talked about kind of these competing demands on energy use or on the environment, on both the, you know, the data side versus other uses?
Yeah. I mean, it's in something like autonomous driving, you can clearly see the benefit, and you can also see some of the downside. And so I think the challenge is technology ultimately is a tool, and you know, if you look across a long period of time, it's a tool that has been used to improve people's lives, and so it takes smart people with ethics to implement the technology in that way, and you know, I'm generally an optimist to think that's what will happen. But if you think about something like autonomous driving, you know, the data is something like 90% of the deaths by traffic accident can be traced back to a mistake the driver made. So you could just right off the start there eliminate a lot of deaths and serious injuries as a result of driver error. And then you get into more esoteric spaces of you potentially could have a lot fewer cars on the road because, you know, the utilization of an automobile in the U.S. is, you know, 7-20%. So you start to drive utilization up, you have a lot fewer automobiles being sold, that uses a lot fewer natural resources. You could have less time spent in traffic, which starts to lower greenhouse gases. So there's lots of potential positives. We just have to, you know, make sure that policy and thinking is kind of keeping up with the technology.
So what about social responsibility as a large organization, as a large corporation? Yeah. So can you talk a little about corporate social responsibility and how you all thought about that?
Yeah, so it's one of the reasons that I was always attracted to Intel. It's one of the reasons I've stayed, is we do try to do the right things in the right way. I'm a believer, though, that to the extent you can integrate it into your business, the benefit becomes magnified, and it also becomes much more than just PR, because you're integrating into your business. Today, I have all the factories that work for me, and they've been they have programs that have been underway for a number of years around reducing energy, using more green energy, recycling water, those kinds of things. And so, just focusing on energy for a second, you know, today we're the largest purchaser of green energy in the U.S. and Ireland. So we're the largest user of green energy. We implement a lot of programs inside our factories where we're trying to reduce energy usage. We have, you know, smart MBAs and BAs that do ROI analysis on that. In many cases, we're getting, you know, a less than 3-year payback on the investments that we're making. And so they're interested in integrating in the business. So I tell them, I say, look, if you can show me anything with less than a 5-year payback, and I can come up with the capital dollars to fund the investment, you know, I'm willing to invest capital dollars in that. And so you come up with something that's sustaining, where people are off looking for how to come up with the things, because I know states will give me the dollars to go fund it. You know, then it becomes integrated in business processes, and that becomes really powerful. And then the outcome of that is, you know, we end up on Forbes' list of most ethical companies, the EPA list of, you know, companies that are being environmentally conscious, and that, of course, helps our brand and everything else.
Well, another element of that in society is diversity and inclusion. So we've been talking about it on campus, we've talked about the business school, something we continue to work on, and you know, we've talked about with many of our corporate partners about working more together. So can you talk a little bit about Intel's goals? You've had an audacious goal. And put it out there and work toward. Can you talk about what you're doing on those lines?
We have been pretty front-footed and leaned in pretty hard on trying to improve the diversity of Intel and generally the diversity of tech. I'll back up a little bit. It's not to get the check mark. I'm a big believer that the more diverse viewpoints you have sitting around a table making a decision, the better that decision is. And lots of examples that I can point to of that has been the case for us. Tech, I think in particular, has not been terribly good at this. And so we put out a goal in 2015 that said we wanted a completely representative workforce by 2020, so within 5 years. So we wanted the population of Intel to match the population of the pools of people from which we hire. We were, I think, way ahead of the game. At the time we did it, we had lots of debates internally of, we might be putting out a goal that we're just going to fall flat on our face. But Intel also is a company that once we started measuring something, we started improving it. And so we knew that by putting that goal out there, we started to improve it. This year, we announced the 2020 goal. We're actually pulling into 2018 because we made so much progress towards it. So next year, we should be at that goal. And just again, once you start measuring something, you improve it. When we put out the goal, so one of the ways you measure this for the government is you say, how many people are we off from that full representation? So think of Intel as a company, about 100,000. When we put that goal out there, we were about 2,500 people off of the representation goal. Today, we're down to less than 800 off of the representation goal. So we've cut that. So we have kind of 800 to go, but we're making great progress, and we think we'll be there next year.
Great, thank you. Some Q&A?
Yeah.
So let's open up now. People would like to ask some questions of Stacey? You always get bonus points for the first question, because that's always the hardest. Well done.
Hello, I'm Will. Out of my curiosity, what do you think 12-year-old Stacy would think of current Stacy?
I'm not sure 12-year-old Stacy, in such ADD, I'm not sure I even know what to make of me. 12-year-old was a long time ago. So I don't know that I can, at 12, I just wanted to play sports and play in the yard. Even as late as high school, I wasn't sure that college was going to be for me. I grew up in Austin, I'm an Austin native, and one of the fundamental learnings for me was as I was getting late in high school, I was also starting to work, and I ended up having a couple of summer jobs doing construction in Austin, and I realized it's hot, it's dangerous, it's messy. I was up, on the infrastructure of buildings as an electrician's assistant. And I said, actually, that college thing's starting to sound pretty good. So that's what kind of, that was one of those fundamental decision points. That was an easy one. We were talking earlier, in college, I believed that I wanted to go be a pilot. And so I sat for the Navy Aviators exam and was accepted in. And so that's one of those fundamental decision points where could have gone one way, could have gone another way. I still look back at that and wonder what would it have been like to have gone the other way. And then the last one, I'm getting a little bit past 12 here, but once I was in graduate school here, one of the fundamental decisions that I had to make was, this was 1987 and 1988, so the U.S. was coming out of a pretty deep recession, but it was coming out of that recession fast. So a lot of jobs were opening up. It was actually a pretty good time to come out as an MBA. And so I had various opportunities, but it was coming down to some opportunities in investment banking on the East Coast or going to work at an operational finance job on the West Coast. And as I said, Steve Jobs coming in really crystallized that I wanted to go somewhere that had real products that could do something good for the world as opposed to being an investment banker. I'd say between those two decisions that I still look back at it'd be really interesting to have been a pilot and have done that. I look back at the one of operations finance versus investment banking as being a really obvious decision for me. I would have been a pretty miserable investment banker, I think, and probably wouldn't have been nearly the charming person that I am today.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hey, Stacey, thanks for coming out. You talked about a lot of really cool technology today, and I was just wondering what your favorite technology of the future is going to be, and if you had any chance to be directly involved with it and just work with it in any way.
I'll state, I couldn't be wrong on this, but when you experience really, I'm talking more from a consumer level, when you experience really good immersive virtual reality, it's game changing. And I know there's a lot of struggle right now, what's the use model and how does it work, but to be able to actually put yourself in a virtual environment is one of those things that when you see it, it's like, wow. And we've been involved in that. And relatively early in the whole VR, so I'm going back a few years now, we took the management committee of Intel, so these are kind of the most senior 15 people. They're all relatively smart people. And we put a VR headset on, so this is kind of before it was really out in the public domain. And they had set up an environment where you're in a virtual reality, you go up in an elevator, you're 20 stories high, you're looking down at this warehouse, and then this is step off. And I watched, of the 15 people, only two of us could take that step. And in full disclosure, I had to close my eyes to do it. But just the that really kind of solidified for me, you put someone in, everybody knew they were staying in a conference room on the fifth floor of our headquarters, you could feel the carpet under your feet, but how that puts you into a virtual world, I really think is game changing. You think about that from the standpoint of business applications or education or entertainment, or being able to help people understand other cultures, which I think really helps bring the world closer together. It's pretty fundamentally changing. So I don't know how that will play out, but that's a technology that I think is gonna have some big implications in our lives. Autonomous driving is another one, to give you the second one, which is, if you'd asked me 2 years ago, I'd say it's interesting and it's going to happen, but it's a 10-year journey. That 10-year journey in 2 years has now become a 5-year journey. And it wouldn't surprise me if it's actually a 3 or 4 year journey from where we are. We have made so much progress in that space from a technology standpoint. And I do think that's just a fundamentally disruptive technology. I think it'll change car ownership, it'll change accident rates, it'll change congestion in cities, it'll change how and where people want to live. One of my team members was saying, it'll change whether you're going to have a garage in your house, those kinds of things. And that starts to change so many different things. So those would be the two I got.
Awesome. Thank you.
Sure.
Speaking of the technology in the future, I am highly interested in the philosophical and human existence perspective of the technology. And for example, autonomous driving, we always have this philosophical ethical conversation. We have this quiz: you are in a car with a broken brake, and there's three men working, and they're one kid.
Yeah.
Which direction would you go?
Yeah.
I think it is time for us to answer that question, have an answer, and put it into the system if we want to have an autonomous driving. And sometimes it kind of freaks me out when I think about so many lives of people will be determined by this a group of engineers who make this technology. So what is your take on that?
So I think that's actually a place where I think regulatory bodies may need to step in and it's a really interesting part of being into play for the people, and you get scared answers, or I get sometimes scared answers. So if you ask a question that says, all right, you're driving along the road, and you can hit the kid that steps out, or you can run head on into the car that has four adults in it, which one do you choose? It's interesting. Most people say hit the car versus the kid. But then you ask questions, says a kid steps out on one side and a puppy steps out on the other, which one do you hit? A lot of people have to really think about whether you hit the puppy or the kid. So I think you get into ethical things that we make on a snap basis, but then, as you say, has to be programmed in. I think that actually is a role where regulatory bodies are gonna have to step in and kind of give that hierarchy. And I think
think actually it's going to have to be something that, that ultimately gets synchronized around a lot of the world, because you shouldn't have a different set of priorities in India versus China versus the US versus Germany. But I think that will happen.
Deans and top.
Deans, yes. Yeah. If they're wearing an orange tie, for sure. Avoid that at all costs. So I think that's a role. It's not really a technology issue. It's a regulatory issue. It's an ethical issue. It's a philosophical issue. I think it can and should be picked up by regulatory bodies. I don't think you want, you know, Intel or Waymo or Chrysler or Ford or an insurance company making those decisions, because they're going to optimize potentially for the wrong thing. So we have a series of values that have actually been the same values that when I joined the company. We've changed the wording of a few of them, and you know, we have a value around quality, we have a value around discipline, we actually have a value around risk taking. And so we define for employees what we want them to do. And our value there is we actually want employees to take risks. Now we use the word informed, so we don't want you just rolling the dice. But you know, the world moves fast, and big companies and small companies and entire industries can become disrupted. And it comes down to, I think you're actually more at risk if you're standing still and not taking risks than you are if you're moving and taking informed risks and then adjusting when you figure out what works and what doesn't work. And that's at every level in the company, you know, from the person working on the factory floor in Malaysia or in Israel or in Ireland or the US, or the senior leader that's running the autonomous driving division. You know, in every case, we say we want you to take risks, but we want them to be informed risks, which means you're thinking about what could go wrong, you're thinking about the probabilities, you're putting in risk mitigation where that's significant. So it's not like it happens at a certain step in your career. You know, from the entry level on, we want employees to take informed risks.
So they give an opportunity to thinking.
Absolutely, absolutely. And on the business side, you know, a lot of your role is to help, because you know, our businesses, by and large, are run by engineering leaders. And so when we bring in somebody like from McCombs, we'll team you up with the business leaders, and your job is to help them, you know, quantify the business plan, come up with the risks, come up with the mitigation, you know, help make that decision of, is this a good informed risk, or is it just a bad risk, or is it not a good business plan to invest in?
My name is Adi, and I'm an undergraduate business freshman. Based on how you spoke about data science, do you think that if you were in college today, you would major in either finance or IS?
Well, so when I did my undergraduate, I was a finance major with a concentration in what used to be called data processing and analysis, which I think kind of evolved into MIS over time. I was drawn to that even back then. But the answer is absolutely. I think, you know, I actually think a finance major gives you a great perspective in terms of operational finance and the ability to evaluate business plans and make decisions. And then as much as you can take in data analytics and understanding that, and as much as you can take in terms of accounting, that would be the other advice I have. I'd say the other field that I find intriguing is the space of kind of social economics, the Stephen Levitt idea of really breaking down how people actually make decisions and
and you combine that with some of the big data analytics that can be done today, and I think it's an emerging and very interesting space. So, you know, the Stacy of today, if I was back in school, I'd be kind of feeling out those kinds of areas.
Hey Stacy, my name is Derek, and I'm a freshman, business major. And my question for you is that could you go over and highlight your experience here at McCombs and the types of resources that you used and what you thought you could have, well, looking back, could have used better or could have experienced more?
Yeah, so I had a great experience at McCombs. I think you got a sense of it. I wasn't a great student. I was okay in high school. I tested way better than I did, you know, because I wasn't necessarily applying myself to my studies. Kind of hit my stride undergraduate and realized that grades were important and that's what was going to open up opportunities. And then by the time I got to graduate school, I was you know, fully in that mode. I'd say the most transformational class I took in the McCombs MBA curriculum was there was a study, summer abroad studying class where we went to the Far East and we visited four or five different countries. Got to visit with a lot of different businesses and government officials in those countries, and I got a real sense of international business. And having lived my entire life in Austin, you know, and then getting to go to China in 1987, it was just this incredibly eye-opening experience. And I realized really how complicated business is, and you know, kind of took it out of the classroom into the more practical space, and I just learned a ton of that. So that was a That was a great experience. In terms of what would I do different, you know, I don't think a lot. I ended up at a great company in a great role. I had enough of the, you know, MIS skills, enough of the accounting skills, coupled with a finance MBA and a lot of exposure to international business. It really kind of set up my career nicely.
Hi, my name is Mia. I'm a senior supply chain management major and wanted to thank you for speaking with us today. I guess my question goes back with all these changes in technology that are occurring. How has Intel's supply chain kind of adapted to these quick changes?
Yeah, I mean, the supply chain is one of those places that a lot of these trends are coming together. You know, the ability to put technology in places where it didn't used to exist, run data analytics on things, be able to have insight into the inventory that sits out there. You know, those are all things that have kind of developed over the last 10 to 15 years, and they fundamentally change our business. And I'll give you a sense of a couple of different areas. So one thing is, you know, the semiconductor business in general used to be kind of really marked by boom and bust cycles. And a lot of that was not being able to tell when inventory was building up and having very long supply chains, you know, between what Intel was manufacturing and then what the motherboard manufacturers in Taiwan were putting in place, what then, you know, Dell or HP were putting into boxes, then stocking on the shelves of Best Buy. You know, you kind of go through that and you have a 6-month supply chain for processors that kind of span through those different inventory points. Well, a relatively small change in demand here just would whipsaw through the thing. So you go from, you know, you can't make enough parts to all of a sudden your factories are running at 60%, you know, utilization because demand has fallen off a cliff. But the reality is demand wasn't changing that much. You just had a very long supply chain. And I don't know if you guys do the beer game anymore. So it's a, she knows it.
Okay.
It's a great game, by the way. It's not drinking beer, for those of you that you know, may not be able to drink beer, but it illustrates this exact point. You have a deep supply chain, one person flips over cards, they're the only person that can see in demand, and then everybody else is making their decisions based on the demand signal that they're being handed. And the way you play the game is every card is 5, you put in 1-6, 1-4, and then every card is 5 again. And you watch these whipsaws through the supply chain. When people see that first 6, they start putting in a bunch of capacity and buffering, and when they see that 4, they're all taking the fill of the gas. It really illustrates what used to happen in the semiconductor supply chain. By being able to take that inventory out, have real visibility into demand levels and stuff, we've created an environment that is just much more efficient for us as a company. And actually gets us a lot closer to our customers, which has lots of benefit. So I'd say it's one of those places where these trends are coming together and have greatly added to the efficiency of the company and frankly the industry.
This may be a very open-ended question, but what's your hopes for the future of Intel and its impact on society?
That's a great question. My hope for the company is, as a big shareholder, that we continue to have success in the marketplace and to grow and to delight our owners from that perspective. As a member of society, that we continue to develop technology that gets used to solve some of the world's big problems. I mean, I know that's at a very high level, but I wish the company that we continue to have success and we continue to make a positive dent on the universe. If we do those two things, I'll be ecstatic.
Hi, my name is Al, and I'm a fourth year electrical and computer engineering student here. So I wanted to ask, how has the structure of Intel internally changed since you've been at Intel, and how do you see it changing in the future with all the new technologies, or just how Intel has to adapt to the business world, both on the business side and engineering side, if you know so.
Yeah. So it really matches our business transformation. So if you think about the company of 10 or 15 years ago, we were kind of the largest single cell organism on the planet that was very focused on the PC market. And every part of Intel was somehow supporting the PC market. And it's because we were seeing extraordinary growth. Even as late as the late 90s, PC penetration rates in the US were measured in PCs per household, devices per household. So in that time period, it was probably 40% of the houses in the US had a computer. If you got out to the emerging markets, so you looked at China or in India, it was probably 7-10% of the households had a computer. Today you measure penetration in terms of devices per person. And my guess is everybody in this room has at least 4 devices that compute. And if you really looked in your drawers and found some of those old tablets, you probably have 6 or 7 devices that compute per person. And so we were just really focused on driving PC penetration, driving our brand, driving our technology. Today, we're a company that's in a much, much more diverse set of businesses. We're the heart of the cloud, and so we're shipping into high-performance computing. We're shipping into Google and Amazon as they build out their clouds. We're doing things in data analytics. And then on the client side, there's an explosion of devices that now need to be smart and connect, and it ranges from applications in virtual reality to autonomous driving to smart cities. And the company's structure has mirrored that. You look at the investments that we've made over the last 5 years, and they've all been in some of these new areas. We've been redeploying resources out of some of the historical areas to fund it. And then we've been structuring the company so that we now have really deep expertise in some of these emerging areas of compute, being able to build solutions in this space. So it just makes us kind of fundamentally different than we were.
One more? Last one. No pressure.
Make it a good one.
Thank you very much, Stacey. What value do you see in blockchain?
Oh, in blockchain? So, I think it's a interesting underlying technology that fundamentally makes things more secure and more democratic when it's done right. So I think it's a pretty exciting technology. It has implications. Again, it's one of these disruptive technologies that has implications on financial systems and many other areas. So it's probably one of the more interesting areas of technology.
Thank you. Eugene, back to you.
Thanks very much.